In the last two videos, I have shown you how I built my custom aquarium. We covered everything from building the tank, the filter, bracing, and painting it, followed by building the stand and light. Now in today's video, we're going to set everything up, explain how it all works, go over costs, and discuss future plans for it. Now when I built this stand, I made sure that I provided extra support to the top of the stand and spent a lot of time preparing the surface to make sure it was flat and true. This is due to the fact that this is a flat bottom glass tank. I didn't want to have to use styrofoam to absorb any irregularities in the stand that might cause pressure points on the bottom of the aquarium. Simply due to the style of the stand, I wouldn't be able to hide it. However, I still decided to put down a couple sheets of sponge. Now this was actually floor underlay that I used. It kept the tank almost flush with the stand while providing a thin layer of protection, just in case. After that, I filled the tank up. However, initial water testing was done in my basement. Before we get too far ahead, let's talk about the filter and how it works. This works on a very simple process. As water is pumped out from behind the filter wall, water will build up in the main aquarium and water level will begin to rise. However, because we created an overflow in the filter wall, water can simply flow back behind it again. I showed you how to create the teeth for this wall in the first video. To size the teeth, I found that if the teeth are 1/4 inch in width and 1 inch tall, it will allow 50 gallons per hour of flow. Having 6 teeth would allow 300 gallons per hour total. Now, I had only planned to run this filter at 6 times the total volume of the tank, meaning that I would filter the tank 6 times per hour. So I only needed a flow of 200 gallons per hour. However, I wanted to make sure that I had a good safety factor as well as flexibility in this filter just in case I would like to increase the flow. So I made the teeth 2 inches tall, giving me the ability to flow 600 gallons per hour. As water is pumped out from behind the filter and water flows back behind it replacing it, this is now time to control how the water will be filtered. The first chamber was to serve as the mechanical section where I filter out the solids. Second would serve as the biological filtration area, followed by what I would typically use as the return pump section. However, I wanted this tank to be universal, so I added an extra section in case I needed more flexibility. The mechanical section didn't need to be big, but I didn't really need the entire chamber. I just needed the top section, so I siliconed a couple pieces of acrylic to the sides for some lighting diffuser to rest on so I can place the sponge on it. Again, tons of space left below it in case I would like to add something else. The next section was biological, and again I added a couple pieces of acrylic to support the lighting diffuser that the media would rest on. I didn't block the entrance here as I wanted the flow to be able to freely flow under and up through all of the media. Otherwise, channeling would occur, as water will always take the path of least resistance. The third chamber I didn't really have a use for if this was going to be a freshwater aquarium, however I decided I would toss in a UV filter as well as a heater in that section just to use it. The last section would be for the return pump. So now with a basic understanding of the filter, let's set it up. The sponge went in first. I used a 30 ppi sponge cut to fit. As for biological media, I used some ceramic media I had on hand from other filters. I jump-started the cycle for this media by placing it in a couple of mesh bags and then tossing it in my main sump for a few weeks. For the third chamber, I found a UV sterilizer that would fit this section. It was an aqua top, and I'm not a fan of this UV and will probably never buy one again, but I did like the fact that I could control the flow, it was fully submersible, and all in one, meaning it contained the pump for it as well. It was just a bit bulky and too pricey for my likings, especially in comparison to what else is available. However, this is what I could find in time for this video. But I do like to try new equipment out sometimes, so I didn't mind buying it. In retrospect, I probably should have just used this as my return pump instead of using another. I also used a Via Aqua titanium 200 watt heater with controller and temperature probe. I've always been a fan of titanium heaters, and this one so far lives up to my expectations. Given the fact that the UV and heater are both in the same chamber, the pump from the UV really helps to ensure that the water is evenly heated and circulated. I would suspect that chances of water flowing through this chamber without getting sterilized and heated first are very slim. Next was the pump. Now I used an Eheim pump rated at 260 gallons per hour, and it had an adjustable flow. You might recognize it from the bulk resupply challenge that I did in the past, as that's actually where I got it, and I really like this pump. So for the return, I used some CPVC and attached to the pump with a piece of hose. I heated the pipe up with a heat gun and bent it to a 90 degree angle. I then picked up a couple of gaskets and placed it on either side of the exit to stop it from vibrating. On the exit, I decided to just use a couple of 90 degree elbows for the return, none of which are cemented. After setting everything up, and despite that I did jumpstart the cycling process, the filter was not fully cycled in time for this video, so I had to continue the cycle with pure ammonia until it is. So although I know many of you want to see it set up with fish, it's simply not ready for fish. In a few weeks, I will do an update on this tank and fully set up with fish. Now let's move on to the costs. The filter cost $25 in acrylic, and I already had the silicone. The tank cost $95 in glass, but I also had the silicone ready for that. The light cost $25, as it would for lengths up to 8 feet. The stand cost $15, and that was just for the 2x3s. I actually already had the paint from when I painted my house, as well as the screws and wood filler from past builds. The plywood was actually kind of free. Now remember this video? Well, the desk I was standing in front of was one I built. I ended up going in a different direction with plans for it, so I decided to take it apart and reuse the plywood. I suppose the cost would be a lot more if I didn't already have a lot of these small things. However, being a DIY kind of person, you simply accumulate these things over time. So the total cost of this tank, filter, stand, and light was $160. Obviously, there are a few smaller things that I didn't count, like the pipe, return, lighting diffuser, that sort of thing, but I already had those things on hand. Again, if you build as often as I do, you simply accumulate these things. We of course are not counting the cost of the equipment, however, they're not the focus here. If I did count them, they would actually cost twice as much as the entire build. Overall though, for $160, I got a custom tank built exactly to my needs and my wants. While the overall cost was a perk here, it's not what I focused on. Sometimes you luck out with the build being cheaper than buying, but not always. In most cases, I build to get exactly what I want and not what somebody else thinks I need. Anyways, I hope that you guys enjoyed this build, and I will do a follow-up on it in a few weeks to show stocking and changes to it that I've made. Until then, I do want to thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next week for a new project.